congratulations to you guys. You're one of the pitchers. I love all of them. The last one I met was my favorite, so you're the luckiest as far as I'm concerned. This last talk that we give is called COVID Victory. And so I think that a lot of times when we talk about these things, and there are a lot of people talking about them, but everybody is so focused on chastisements, on wars, on persecutions, okay? And what I will tell you is that when my experiences began, that was a very prominent thing that I focused on. And the reason was because it was what I was shown. And this is the reason that I mentioned to the Father and I said, early on, I think it's a warning. It was clear, very clear to me. But as I went on with Father Desmond's direction, and I would say this publicly, I don't know if you ever had a chance to attend one of Father's retreats or hear one of his talks at the SCRC conference in LA or even hear one of his homilies. But he has a gift of wisdom. And I guess what I'm trying to say is I don't know what I would have done without that man's direction. He does not use spiritual direction, but for whatever reason took me under his wing. And he had more of an impact on me than any other person in my entire life because of the things that I was dealing with. He taught me how to forgive. It was his direction that taught me, that led me to forgiveness. It was his direction that led me deeper into the scriptures, deeper into spirituality. All the tools were there, I just didn't know how to use them. And so, I would say, Father Desmond he's had such a profound impact on me. I think he was just doing what he normally does, but he will never realize how important what he did for me was until he gets to heaven and sees it. So, I have to give him credit. And so in putting this talk together, these talks together, which I normally do, I was talking to Peter, who's up at work, and I was starting to talk to him. But I have to do it this way, otherwise I end up wasting time and I don't allow the Spirit to flow. If I put everything in brackets and try to do it from a tangible way to normally prepare a talk, which is really the proper way to do it, everything comes to me the night before. And I write it down in a notebook. And in pondering, actually was on the phone, I think I told you that last night I was on the phone with Father, kind of talking to him about the book of Daniel and stuff, and just something that I thought I should share with him. That's what I was instructed to do, the bigger things to give to those in authority that know what to do with them. Because, again, I don't. That's why I rely on the clergy so much. But in putting these talks together, I started thinking back to my early years with Father Nesbitt. And I was so focused on the apocalypse, and so focused on the day of the Lord, and so focused on the chastisements, and so focused on the persecutions, because what was given. He directed me, he said, I want you to start studying something else. And so I was like, that's where he started to teach me, there's different names for the Holy Spirit in Scripture. And the more you understand those names, the more you're going to understand the person of the Holy Spirit and how he operates in your life. Fire, wind, the paraclete, the helper, living water, the dew of heaven, the life of God, on and on and on. So you can, in my Bible here, it looks like, well, I hate to say it, but it kind of looks like an LGBT rainbow with a lot of colors. Because you, and do this, if you use pens, I don't want to use gel pens, because any other kind of felt pen will bleed through the pages. But gel pens come in a million different colors, and they don't bleed through. So what I ended up doing, I took that little piece of advice and began to study not only the Holy Spirit, but I began to study angels. I began to study miracles. I began to study healings. I began to study the prophets. I began to study allegories within scripture. I mean, my Bible is filled with all different colors because I just got one little direction my father asked for. But in putting this talk together, what I started to think about was, let's, you know, we've done the spiritual warfare. See, I think you guys kind of see where I'm going with this. It's my hope. Because I really felt it inspired the last night when I was writing it down. We started with everyone, the majority of this, of the people in this room, not realizing they're engaged in spiritual warfare every single day of their life. We went from that to understanding that everyone is engaged in spiritual warfare. We went from that to understanding that when we conquer our own demons, this is where the battle begins within the soul. When we conquer those through God's grace, only then are we equipped to step out onto the real battlefield. Dealing with your own demons is boot camp. And so this is why the process is so important, because we're still struggling with this temptation or that temptation, or we get attacked by this, you will get to a point to where the demons will no longer approach you. They fear you. I've had this comment confirmed. Okay, it's with a family member that was living a very, very simple life and decided to come back into the church and began to have dreams, very vivid dreams. And dreams that when they were telling me, I understood what they meant immediately, but I'll share one with you. I was talking to someone here about it earlier. This person had a dream. They were walking. Them and I were walking down the street. We were being approached by this very charismatic, young, well-dressed, handsome young man, probably about 36, 35, right in there, okay? And in the dream, the person that was walking with me immediately recognized it as Satan. See, Satan will never come to you in the way that you think. He will never appear to you as he is, okay, the majority, until you, you reach union. You know, he only appeared to St. Faustina and, you know, other saints, things. But he's never allowed to appear to you that way until you're ready to handle it. Okay, he'll always come in a very beautiful way, very tempting way, seductive way. You know, I used to tell the youth group at school, men, I would give young men a talk on impurity. And I said, Satan's never an impurity the way that he is, because if he did, he would run like hell. Satan's going to appear to you in the form of a young Catholic woman that you may know in her parish, knocking on your door in the middle of the night, going to sleep with you. That's Satan. That's how Satan operates the majority of the time. He's always going to present himself as something that is alluring. So this man approaches us, and instead of walking past us, he turns around and he stands there and kind of waits till we get there. And as soon as we walk by him, he starts walking with us, but in between us. And this dream was so revealing to this person, right? Because I've been praying for a conversion for years and telling him, you know, you need to stop, you're going to hell, you know, or why will it be good? Anyway, that's what you do with people you really love, right? So we're walking down the street, and Satan grabs their hand and then takes hold of my hand. And the person was trying to pull away and couldn't. And it was a strong grip crushing their hand, and they could not get away. And so finally, they yanked and they got away and were able to, like, kind of look sideways. And that's when he noticed that the devil was holding my hand. And the devil was trying to get away from me. And his hand was burning and causing pain. That's the difference of being in a state of grace and not being in a state of grace. Okay? So, again, this building up of understanding we're all involved in spiritual warfare. The demons that we fight, the main demons we fight are our own. Okay, you can conquer 90% of the demons within your own life through forgiveness and mercy. Again, that is the key to the door that opens to sanctification. Then we become sanctified. We begin to run the process of sanctification. We're no longer in a state of purification. Okay, per se, in that state, purgative state. We move into the illuminative state of spirituality. Okay, and so then we begin to understand the battle that's being waged right in front of us, which I think most of you do. granted the last talk, I had to go into some details. I want to make sure that you understand the magnitude of what we're talking about here. Because what inevitably what we are discussing is the coming of the kingdom of God. What the church has been praying for 2,000 years. That is what we're discussing. And it's really happening. It's not a conspiracy theory. We're not all losing our minds. When the scholars and people, or even anybody, when you just look at things logically and put them together, there's no way around it. Heaven is screaming. Okay? And so I want to move from the battle that is right in front of us, that I talked about in the last talk, into the next portion of this. And that is to understand our role. Because, again, what happens is when we talk about these things, you get the preachers, you know, usually non-Catholic preachers, always talking about God's wrath. You know, that's one of the ways they all talk the same. You ever notice that? Always good. God, wrath. They do that like at the end of every word. You know, maybe you're running them. Okay, then, so, you know, people can get so caught up in the chastisements and the wrath that they lose focus on hope. And that's why I wanted to title this talk, Hope and Victory, because inevitably that's what we're talking about. The coming of the kingdom of God, the triumph of the Immaculate Heart of Mary. It's already done. There is no way around it. And that is the reason that we're seeing such a raging devil now. Chasing after anything and everything that he can get, he doesn't have a lot of time. Our loved ones, our marriages, our families, our children, starting wars, starting conflict, corruption in government, and on witchcraft, this transgender movement, which Pope Francis himself has called demonic. Transgender theory is demonic. That's the Pope. You know, don't believe everything you hear about the bad stuff about Pope Francis. I've spoken a little bit about this. I'll tell you some more things about Pope Francis. Do you know Pope Francis is the fourth pope that has said that he even has entered the church in one form or another? Pope Francis said that no one even has entered the church. We have another pope, the son of Satan, has entered the church. Pope John Paul, we are in the final confrontation between the church and the anti-church, the gospel and the anti-gospel. Christ in the Antichrist. Pope Benedict says something similar. Four popes in the world have said this. So, pray for Pope Francis. There is an elegant being within the church. It is very powerful and very deceptive. The most important thing is what I tell my viewers on my YouTube channel when I talk about these things, stay in the middle of a boat. Do not go too far to the left because you're going to fall off. Not going too far to the right because you're going to fall off. Okay. Another way to put it is if you're on the left and you're progressive, a modernist, they like to call it. If you run too far, you're going to fall off the end of the boat. If you're so traditional and you don't move with the boat, it slips underneath you anyway and you fall off the back. Stay in the middle of the boat and move with the current of the church. Okay? And pray for bishops. For clergy, for priests, and especially for the Pope. Pray for the Pope. We have well-known Catholics now attacking the chair of Peter. All out attacking. We have to be very, very careful, okay? So, the triumph of the Immaculate Heart of Mary, that's where it begins, right? The hope part of it. It's already done. What did she say? In the end, my Immaculate Heart will triumph. The Holy Father will consecrate Russia to me. Russia will be converted. These are absolutes. And the world will be given a period of peace. In the end, my Immaculate Heart will triumph. So there's nothing to fear. I called you in an army earlier, and I was half right. Remember in the first talk I told you to remember what word that I told you to remember because it's going to come up and be important. Do you remember which word that was? It's such an important word. No? So the very first talk, it's one of the first lines I said. Kingdom. Kingdom. Oh, well, the plan was a good one too, yeah. I didn't say that though, Jesus did. So the one that I said was kingdom is going to be an important word. It's going to be a spot. Do you understand what it means to be a part of a kingdom? I call you an army. I see an army. That is what Our Lady is gathering, an army of prayer warriors. Okay? It may come to a point where men have to stand up and fight. It's happened in the past. It happened with the Maccabees. Do you understand what it means to be a loyal army? Think about that. Because that's where you are. Loyalty. We are royalty, sons and daughters of the living God, heirs to the entire kingdom through adoption. How then can you see that without getting excited? It's like being a part of the Lord of the Rings, except it's real, right? How do you not? Royalty. This is why Paul talks about receiving the everlasting crown of life. Can you imagine being crowned by the King of Kings himself? This is what we're being called to. You be our members of a royal army, a kingdom. If you walk into a throne room, how would you address a king? Let's say the king. How could we say no to the Queen Mother? Do you start to see how important this call is and what it represents? We're not talking about an earthly kingdom. We're not talking about an earthly king. We are talking a royal king, an eternal king. Life itself, love itself, truth itself, glory, honor, courage, bravery, every virtue the church teaches, it's all there. The fruit of the mystery is patience. The fruit of the mystery is perseverance. The fruit of the mystery is love. It's all there. We are a royal army being called by the Queen of Heaven herself to engage the gates of hell in the times in which we're living. And we are being given the weapons to do it. She begins by saying, in the end, my immaculate heart will triumph, and the world will begin a period of peace. The second world war breaks out, and then we receive the message of divine mercy. Now I'm going to connect these for you. How many of you remember the prayer that was said by an angel of peace about? Talk to the children. We should, because it's the exact same thing as divine mercy. He appeared with the Eucharist, remember? Prostrate himself. Father, I offer you the body, blood, soul, and divinity of the dear beloved Son of the Word, Jesus, present in all the tabernacles of the world in reparation for the sins and offenses, right, and so on. A paraphrase of divine mercy before divine mercy is ever given to us. I offer you the body, blood, soul, and divinity. Now let's look at the other connection. What was the promise? The promise was peace. If people turn back to God. So when we receive divine mercy, where is Jesus so blessing them? The world will not have peace until it turns to trust and mercy. What is turning to trust? Turning in trust to His mercy. The entire message of divine mercy is Eucharistic centered. It is turning the trust to the sacred heart merciful Lord of Jesus, present in the Eucharist. Remember, what we're talking about is a Eucharistic reign. So in other words, Mary promised, prophesied that the Lord will be there in the period of peace. It's a surety. But as Jesus said, the Lord will not have that promise until it turns with justice and mercy. But the very fact that Mary already promised us that it will happen is to say that eventually every single person on the face of the planet will turn with trust and mercy to the Lord Jesus. And the entire world will be converted. Russia, China, and then the church is renewed. It is the glorious reign of the church, the thousand-year reign in the book of Revelation. I have proven that beyond reasonable doubt, just the scripture alone, to scholars and theologians alike. It's not a heresy. It's not a literal thousand years. To call it that would be a heresy. It's a period of time, but it's a period of time in which the church, Christ reigns on earth through the church. The new heavens and the new earth in which righteousness dwells. This is what it is to be part of a kingdom. And I don't know, I can't speak for any of the other guys here. I know, but I've kind of talked about this stuff before. It's valiant to want to be a knight. I think every little boy has this kind of in them when they're a little boy. They want to be the superhero. They want to be the conqueror. They want to do the right thing. And then, again, it's not a fantasy. It's not a made up imagination of a little child. Although we should approach it like children, but the mind of a child is very, very real. And what we're talking about is being knighted. A king and queen by the King of Kings and Prince of Peace. We have to allow Christ to rise in our hearts. We die to ourselves. Christ lives in us. Paul talks about it. I no longer live. Christ lives in me. We become vessels through which the power of the Holy Spirit flows. This is the way the world is going to be renewed. It's not going to be done with weapons and bullets and refuges and stocking up on extra food. It's going to be won by faith, hope, and love. The three main virtues. So now let's tie this message in with Luisa Figueroa. I'm not really familiar with Luisa Figueroa, but I can tell you I'm eating it up like no tomorrow. Because the theology is so profound, and it is the one link in the chain that I had been looking for with the message of Babylon and Divine Mercy. What does the spirit of peace look like? It makes perfect sense with the writings of Luisa Figueroa. And is this divine will? Is the very life of God or the operation of God? The movement of the Holy Spirit dwelling within us. This is, I believe, the event of divine mercy. Divine mercy isn't something. Divine mercy is someone. And when you study the theology of divine mercy, now is the time for mercy. And it focuses on God's mercy as an event. Well, what is that event? That event is the second Pentecost. But we have to open ourselves up completely to receive that gift. It is the very life of God, the will of God, the very life of God. What is Jesus self asking him? I wish you pour out my divine life into souls. You're the same. So, in other words, he's given the gift to Luisa Figueroa. He tells her he wants people to have this, and then follows it up with St. Faustina by giving her the same gift, and then telling her to write, I desire to pour my divine life into souls. It is the very life of God operating within us. what the theologians refer to as fusion. Well, it doesn't do away with your will. Your will, because of your love for God, is moving perfectly in unison with His. Now think back about what I said about the chaplain. You will gain everything you ask for through the chaplain if what you ask for is in accordance with my will. So let me ask you this. It's obviously God's will that the world experience a period of peace, otherwise there are some other way to promise it. Jesus said we won't have that period of peace until we turn and trust His mercy. Why? And then we can gain everything we want through the chaplet if it's in accordance with His will. Why are we not praying the chaplet of divine mercy and praying for a hastening of the triumph of the Immaculate Heart of Mary? Which, in fact, is that gift being given to the human race? Why are we not praying the chaplet of divine mercy and asking God to prepare us to receive that gift of living in the divine will? See, all these prayers are in accordance with His will. He's already made it clear through the message of Fatima and through the message of divine mercy and the writings of Luis and Pedro. It's all you have to do is tie the three together. They are very, very much connected. Okay, so in other words, the message of divine mercy is the key that will bring about the promise that was made in Fatima. The world will not have peace, what was promised to Fatima, until it turns to trust and mercy. This is why one of the main prayers of divine mercy is so simple. Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you. Say it. Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you. Jesus, I trust in you. I've talked to a number of you, and certain things going on, right? Children, or sickness, or pain, or a loved one. Get on your knees and say, Jesus, I trust in you. You're going to say, I can't. I've done everything I can. It's an extremely hard thing to do, to let go and let God. Jesus, I trust in you. The world has to turn to Jesus and trust. To His mercy, before the world will be granted a period of peace. But the period of peace is already promised. So as I said, it's only a matter of time before the entire world is sealed with it. You realize what that means? Everybody's Catholic. Yeah. And then maybe if we're lucky, you know, we can kind of rub it in a little bit. Told you, the turn of time. It's a beautiful thing. Okay? The Jews will be converted. Judaism intertwined with Catholicism. This is probably when the next temple will be built during that period. It's an amazing thing what God is doing. But we have to understand the call. We have to. One of the main tricks of the devil is to get us so down on ourselves to think God will never choose me. He's not asking me to do that. I'm not worthy. In Jesus tells Faustina the two things, the two main things that stand in the way of becoming a saint is anxiety and discouragement. We should be anxious about nothing. I can feel the peace in this room. Am I the only one? Do you feel this? God is peace. God is love. You can walk through fire in absolute faith and not be burned. As a matter of fact, it's promised in Scripture, in one of the prophets. You shall walk through the fire, you shall not be burned. You shall walk through the waters and it won't touch you. God is paving the way over and over and over and over again in Scripture. God is my refuge. The Lord is the refuge for those that love Him. The Lord is the refuge. We have to be built up in faith. Jesus, I trust. to you. One of the most amazing things that I stumbled upon in my studies was that if you look at the events that the church has to go through in the end times, they line up perfectly with the major Jewish feasts. Did you know that? It's an amazing thing. So you have Passover, Pentecost, and then what is known as the Day of Atonement, or Yom Kippur. Okay? The Day of Atonement, according to Christian theology, is the Day of the Lord. What is the university preparing us for? The Day of the Lord. Did you know that the Feast of Divine Mercy fulfills the holiest day in Judaism, which is the Day of Atonement? There are so many connections here, it is beyond description. The Day of Atonement, the priest would enter the Holy of Holies, sprinkle blood, make sacrifices for his sins and the sins of the people, and then come out and pronounce judgment. That happened only once a year. And what's happening now? Jesus is calling us to his merciful heart to be sanctified in his blood that he has sprinkled to prepare us for the high priest to come out and pronounce judgment. It goes on and on and on. There's no way around us. But you have Passover. What was Passover? Ultimately, it was the passion of Jesus. The Eucharistic sacrifice, the Last Supper, that's what the Eucharist was given, that he went through his passion. What has to happen to the church? She has to pass the final trial in which she follows her Lord through his passion, death, and resurrection. What happened after the passion? 40 days after Pentecost. What are we talking about? The triumph of the Immaculate Heart of Mary, and then Pentecost. And then we have the Day of Atonement, the Day of the Lord, the removal of sin. This is the order I'm giving it to you right now. Do you know the next Jewish feast is the Feast of Tabernacles? The Feast of Tabernacles. This is the period of peace. This is where our Eucharistic Lord is kept. The Feast of Tabernacles, or the Feast of Booths, they call it as well. Do you know, in Scripture, very often, the word tabernacle or tent is actually a reference to the body. Taught by the first Pope, the Lord has told me that I must put this tent aside, that I will not leave the orphans. This is when he prayed over the God of the Pope. Peter knew he was going to die, and he speaks of it as putting the tent of the body inside. It's a powerful thing. This has been planned from creation, from the time that the law of Moses was given. Okay, so to understand the epochs a little bit, you have the fiat of creation, which went from Adam to Noah. And then there was the flood, and he left a remnant. What did he do? He destroyed wickedness, he destroyed sin. He left a remnant. Then we go through the process of getting over all of this preparation for the fiat of redemption, the incarnation of Christ, which opened us up to the end times. And so we've been living in the end times since the incarnation of Jesus. The church has always taught that, Scripture teaches that. But there is an end to the end times. Okay? So from the incarnation 2,000 years later, now we're moving. And you can see right at the end of this, the message of Fatima, the message of divine mercy, and the writings of Luis Sabino, instruction, just like now, before the purification and fire. And when the world is purified in fire, what's he wanting to do? Leave a remnant. And then you move forward. So it's not hard to understand. Okay? And we aren't to focus on chastisement. Scripture over and over and over again says that chastisements and wrath of God are revealed for the unrighteous, were reserved for the unrighteous, reserved for the wicked. It's a beautiful thing to understand. so when we begin to understand these steps, understand where we are in these end times in which we're living, if anything, we should be rejoicing. Because heaven has promised that you are to be crowned kings and queens, royalty, in an eternal kingdom of God. It's amazing, absolutely amazing, to be a part of something like that. Have you ever pondered that before anything was ever created, even before the first eon, God, in his infinite wisdom and eternity, knew that you would be here, that you would be living in these times in which we're living, and he chose you. Each one of us have been chosen to play a part, to play a role in this, to be a part of a royal army, that is going to destroy sin and send Satan back to hell, in a kingdom in which righteousness dwells, like the apostle said. Jesus tells us, entrust everything to me, and do nothing on your own, and you will always have great freedom of spirit, no anxiety, peace. Trust him with your loved ones, trust him with your children, trust him in your relationships, trust him with everything. Listen to this. Luisa P. Perez writes, the gift of living in the divine world is a gift that's being given now, even in portions. Okay? And again, like a frog in a pot, everything builds up in crescendos to that fulfillment. Okay? So the chastisements build up. They're all going on while the graces are building up. While the graces are building up, certain people receiving the gift. It ultimately ends with the destruction of the wicked, the renewal of sin, and a period of peace. Do you know that scripture describes this? So imagine this. We started out in Eve, we got the fall, right? And we move all the way forward to Jesus, all the way forward to the period of peace. Do you know what is happening? When Jesus died on the cross, he took history on his head, and we started going back to the other direction. So if you were to take Adam, when he fell, and then the generations after Adam, okay, up to Noah, do you know those people lived 400 or 500 years? Even 800, 900 years? So if it isn't the days of Noah as it were, then it will be in the days of the Son of Man. The world is purified in fire. Do you realize that we're moving back towards the Garden of Eden? People are going to live much longer. That's actually written in the prophet Isaiah. He who dies a mere youth dies at 100 years old. A mere youth. They will no longer beget children for destruction. What does that tell you? The sacrament of marriage is there. Because you can't have children outside of marriage, that's fornication, it goes against God's law. But notice, even though they live longer, they still die. What is death? Death is the punishment for sin. Which means that it hasn't been completely, it's not completely done. So it's a period of sanctification, not divinization. We're given portions of it. It has to happen in steps. Divinization, you would be eternal forever, right? You live forever, eternal life. The very fact that death is yet to be destroyed tells us it's not over. Death is destroyed in the book of Revelation after the 1,000-year reign. And according to St. Paul, it is the last thing to be destroyed. That's extremely important when you study the book of Revelation, because what it tells us is the last thing to be
the spray doesn't happen until I leave the house in the rain. So it can't be done. Jesus tells us, and tell me if this doesn't sound familiar, when you glorify your self-will, my will reigns in you. What does Jesus want to do? Pour out his divine life. Divine life, the will of God. When we live in the divine will, we live in peace, we live in union with him. Okay? That was the other. That's really the gift of the divine will, is when the divine will reigns in our souls. Okay? And this is the root of Faustina. This is how the two are connected. The path to this gift is divine mercy. There's no other way a gift can be given. It has to be mercy. Because the fact of the matter is, we don't deserve anything. We don't deserve anything. We are promised if we're faithful. Jesus tells Faustina, I desire that you live according to my will in the most secret depths of your soul. I desire that you live according to my will. Paul talks about this with praying the Holy Spirit to teach us how to pray, that we don't know how to pray as we ought, but it is the Spirit that intercedes and prays through us in accordance with the will of God. Therefore, the prayers are answered. You see how I'm kind of putting this together with the Divine Mercy Chaplet? You're getting everything you wish for, everything you ask for, through the chaplet, if what you ask for is in accordance with my will. So, do we want the divine will to reign within us, the divine life of God? Yes, we should pray the chaplet for that. Do we want loved ones to go to heaven that would otherwise be lost? Yes, because through the realms, you can move throughout eternity. This is one of the things that I wrote down theologically in the writings that I did on divine mercy that I didn't understand. I didn't know anything about Lisa Pioretta. I didn't understand the theology of the realms. But God goes outside of time. And one of the promises that he makes to Faustina is if you pray a chaplet for the dying, I promise to stand in between my Father's justice. Right? Not as just judge, but as merciful Savior. They may be again in the lower realms of purgatory, but they'll make it. So you realize you can pray the chaplet now in the realms of the Lisa Pioretta that she was writing of, and place that chaplet at the moment of your loved one's death. Is it not possible to go to heaven? This is how we start snatching souls out of the hand of the devil. This is the battle we've been called to. This is the way we wage the war. Every single one of us, has a responsibility to answer this call. Every single one of us will have to answer to Jesus how we responded to that call. And I want you to keep at the forefront of your minds. It doesn't matter if you're a man or a woman. It doesn't matter if you're an adult or your child. It doesn't matter if you're handicapped. It doesn't matter what age you are. It doesn't matter. Every single one of you are a part of a royal army, a royal court, a holy nation. I get excited thinking about this. God does the most amazing things. Have you ever thought about this? That on earth, when there's a war, when you're being approached by, your kingdom is being approached by an overwhelming force, the king calls up his troops, he calls his best soldiers, and they prepare for war. And he sends the army out. Do you know in our case, Jesus, sitting on his throne, saw the kingdom coming under attack, took his crown off his head, took off all his royal clothes, and walked through the city gates out into the battlefield, and handed himself over to save us. The difference this time is he's not going by himself. The difference this time, he's not going to hand himself over. The difference this time is he's clothing us in righteousness and saying, follow me in the battle. The difference this time is Satan will be destroyed. Praise God. Enter into this battle. Wherever you are in your spiritual life, it begins in your soul. It begins with our own beings. Then move forward. Okay? As I said, making reparations, sacrifices. In the end, what's going to happen? Like I say, if you follow this path, it's taught by the saints, it's taught by the church. All you have to do is listen. Satan will fear you. I'm telling you right now, all of hell is trembling at the power to be unleashed through God's righteousness, through His church, through His holiness, through our Lady's army. And that army is you. And there are so many groups. I don't know where it is, maybe a few talks ago, that I was invited. I looked out and then we saw a group of people. That's when I started realizing I'm looking at a wrong people. So don't underestimate yourself. Don't doubt yourself. Trust in Jesus. Have faith in God. Because He is going to do things through you you can't possibly imagine. May God bless you. May He keep you. May He cause His face to shine upon you. And may He grant you His face. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you so much. Yeah, I'm down.